Okay. Thanks, Jen, for the introduction. Tom asked me this morning what ontogenetic meant. Ontogeny is life, history, development. It's development is what we go throughout life. And what I'm going to talk about is like how asymmetry within a life cycle actually translates up to population and community dynamics. I'm interested in modeling ecological complexity. And this is just one of the systems that I've been interested in. But when this is modeled, the classical approach is just like ditch all the complexity. We replace everything by just variables that represent densities of biomass of individuals. And my claim is always that this approach is actually due to the fact that the two people that inspired this development were not biologists, and were thinking more about cute mathematics and equations. The problem is that this is really modeled after like interacting particle systems. It assumes that all individuals are identical, and that the only two processes that actually change the population are reproduction and mortality. It has a very huge impact, because even a classic textbook in ecology, this is the standard textbook that undergraduate students, defines population dynamics as changes in numbers. Nothing else but changes in numbers. So also in the textbook, there is a population-based paradigm that underlies population and community ecology. And the question is there a problem? And what is the problem, if there is any? Well, the problem actually originates for somebody that is at least well known as Volterra and Lotka. Darwin emphasized actually the fact that this detail, especially the detail of individual life history, mattered for all kinds of aspects of ecology. It matters for population growth and democracy. It matters for the community dynamics, and especially what Darwin, of course, emphasized was that it mattered for life history evolution. So the question that I've worked on basically all my academic life is like how ontogeny or life history development affects population community dynamics. And especially the question, does it make a fundamental difference if we take it into account, yes or no? And my short answer is yes, it turns basically everything upside down. And that's what I want to convince you about. And I also want to show you where it comes from. An important fact that I have to tell you and that I have to emphasize is that the population and community context actually feeds back on the life history. It's absolutely important because everything I'm going to show you comes about from the population feedback onto individual life history. And that's why I cannot capture my results in a cute little equation because of this nonlinear feedback. The most important aspect of development is growth in body size. We at least have to double, and some organisms double slightly more. This is a cod. Cod can actually grow 10 to the 9th in body mass during its life. And so within a population, you cannot really assume that all individuals are the same. There is always a structure, and that is related to a density over a body size axis. The interesting part about body size is that it is very determined by conditions. So here you see three fishes that are exactly the same age. They are 4 years old. But the small... Oh. You know better than I do. The small one in the middle... Trying to find. Please stand by. There it is. Okay. The small one in the middle has actually grown up in a lake that is, the lakes were separate, were just next to each other, same kind of environmental condition, only the density was in the lake from where the small guy comes from, very much higher than in the other lake, and so these differ almost an order of magnitude in weight. This is at a large scale. It also happens at a minute scale. These are parasitic wasps, and they are electron scanning microscope photos of a parasitic wasp that grows up in the egg of a Drosophila. And this one has grown up alone in one single egg. This one has grown up with three conspecifics in an egg. And there are actually people that study how this interaction affects the physiology of the individuals. They've shown that the brain size of that guy, of the small guy, is much much smaller, with all kinds of impacts on its neurological conditions. So the tool, the type of approach that I use is called what is called structured population modeling. And basically it comes from a distinction of a state concept at the individual level. Individuals are described by state variables like age, size, or whatever you want to characterize your individuals with. And an individual lives in an environment. And the environment can be resource density, predation risk, whatever. The modeling that takes place is not at the population level, in contrast to the classical ecological models. The modeling takes place at the individual level. We model the life history, the development of an individual through life in terms of the development rate, the reproduction, the mortality, and its impact. The rest is really bookkeeping, and we can do that with different types of mathematical frameworks, matrix models, integral projection models, or physiologically structured population models. The latter one is the one I use because that one can actually take into account that there is this feedback of a population onto the environment. And I emphasize here, this is about individual organisms, but I've also worked on cell populations where you actually, where the model at the individual cell level is a network of interacting chemicals that describe the cell cycle. Mortality and impact. Oh, mortality simply means like individuals dying, right? And the so what you have is at the how you lift how this is lifted to the population level is that you have a distribution over the individual states, and the type of equation that you actually then use, for example, partial differential equations to lift that to a density description. How the density function changes as a function of mortality, reproduction, and development. And impact is the impact of a single individual on its environment. Think about a consumer eating food. The impact of a single individual is negligible, but simply the population level impact is non-negligible, and that's why you get actually this density-dependent non-linearity. So all nonlinearities happen through this environment. And that's a very important distinction due to Metz and Diekmann in the 1980s. And it's a very powerful distinction, just not only to model this at an ecological scale, but also at an evolutionary scale. Here is a specific example. This is the simplest size-structured model where you assume that individuals are born at a certain size. You have a growth law that describes how fast their size increases as a function of their own body size and resources, how much they reproduce, what they take in as resources, depending on size and the resource density, and they have a mortality rate. Typically, what you then get is like you have a partial differential equation for a size distribution of the population. There is term that describes basically advection, which is the growth of individual through the size range, and there is mortality, which is a kind of a loss rate. Yeah?
Is size typically a proxy for all kinds of things that would be age dependent? Like, are you building in presumption that mortality is independent of age, conditioned on your size and these sorts of things?
You can actually extend the dimension of your eye state. I just take here a one-dimensional eye state, which is size. It's different from age because this growth rate is non-constant. And actually, in fact, if you take into account both size and age, you cannot write it down as a partial differential equation anymore because the support is usually then not two-dimensional anymore, but actually goes to a one-dimensional manifold in a two-dimensional space. Specific aspect of this model is that actually the boundary condition of the PDE is coupled to the solution, and this is the reproduction term. The right-hand side is the total population reproduction, and that is what appears at the boundary as mass. And the coupling happens through this ordinary differential equation, which is this environment variable that actually affects all these rates. But is then depleted through foraging of the consumer. This is a model that is known from different fields, from ecology, but also from cell biology, already since the 50s. It has not really been studied very extensively until the 80s, actually. You can build this in. I've actually restricted myself in this lecture completely to where consumers forage on one resource, because if they somehow switch between the resources, there's a lot more complexity. And I will give a lecture actually on May 1st about that. So as Jen said, I wrote this book couple of years ago about the impact of development, and especially the size structure on population and community ecology. And I'm not going to talk in much detail about what is in that book because it's much too complicated and it can be done much simpler. But it takes the inspiration from there. My lecture takes the inspiration from there. One thing that actually was a theme in the whole that came out of the studies we summarized in that book is that increasing mortality actually changes population structure. You see here an example that increasing juvenile mortality actually increases juvenile biomass in the population. So this is kind of weird. I increase mortality on a specific class of individuals. I get more juveniles back. You can have the same whether you increase adult mortality, then adult biomass can increase. And in case juveniles and adults feed actually on different things, then you can actually have that you can increase mortality for all individuals and nonetheless your population growth in abundance. And as you can see on top here, juveniles are more efficient foragers, adults more efficient foragers, only adults compete for a limiting resource. So it has to do with that there are differences between juveniles and adults. And that's where this comes from. I have one slide with data. I can give many more examples. But we actually set up, we meaning Leonard Persson, my co-author on this book and longtime collaborator, we set up these experiments to actually test this idea that if you increase mortality of, for example, juveniles, that juvenile biomass can go up. And these are population-level experiments over two-year time spans where we really could show that, indeed, mortality increased the juvenile biomass, whether it was targeted at juveniles or at adults. So the main topic, what I want to do today, is actually show like what life history characteristics cause these effects and under which condition doesn't it show up. The starting point is a very simple model, consumer resource. So I have a resource density R, a production rate, a foraging rate. This is a classical model in ecology, and it is considered to be very general because it captures the bare essence of this consumer-resource interaction. It makes two fundamental predictions. One is that if you increase mortality by that actually the consumer density goes down. And this is one something that we saw in the structured model was invalidated, so I want to understand why it actually comes about. A second prediction is as long as this P of R is a decreasing function of R, then the equilibrium is stable. If you want to extend it to some structure, the easiest thing is to do is like differentiate between juveniles and adults. And then a logical for an intuitive approach would be, well, we just have foraging rates of juveniles and adults, and we have a maturation rate and a reproduction rate and mortality, and these differ only in a kind of scaling factor from each other. So juveniles and adults more or less have the same dependence on the resources. They only scale in an absolute magnitude and do different things. Even though this is a kind of intuitively obvious choice, it has rather drastic consequences because it basically does away with all the possible effects of structure. If you write it as the total sum of densities and the fraction of juveniles, you can derive this set of equations for the total consumer density C and the fraction of juveniles Z. And as you can see, this Z is some kind of function of Z itself times a growth rate of R. Which means that for T to infinity, this Z, the distribution over the two classes, will actually go to its equilibrium value, which is independent of any resource conditions. And variations in resource only affect the convergence rate. So in the end, basically what you end up with is an unstructured model capturing the full dynamics of your system. The necessary assumptions for that to happen is actually that maturation, reproduction have the same dependence on the resource density and only are differing by a scalar factor, and that the mortality rate is the same for both stages. And we can generalize this to arbitrary many stages as long as these two conditions hold. In fact, this phenomenon I first discovered in the psi-structured model that I showed you before, which is also a consumer resource model, but now taking into account a body size structure. But both these two models actually boil down to a simple description of in terms of ODEs under what I call a conditions of ontogenetic symmetry. And what is ontogenetic symmetry? It's really a collection of three invariant principles. The mortality should be the same, independent of your state, whether you're a juvenile adult or whether in a size-structured context, independent of body size. There should be some kind of invariance in the production, that is either maturation or reproduction. And in the size-structured model, that's a mass-based measure of growth in biomass through somatic tissue and through offspring production. And on a mass-specific basis, your ingestion rate should be the same across your life history. Under these conditions, then actually any structured model of such a consumer resource interaction reduces to a two-dimensional description in terms of total resource density and total biomass. And it's in fact the structure dynamics decouple from the dynamics of the total abundance in the system. And so even though this looks like an unstructured model, it accounts for a complete stage or size distribution of consumers. And the consumers differ in rates of ingestion, growth, and reproduction, but they do so following specific scaling laws. So basically what you can conclude is that this the approach that we have taken in the last about 100 years in population ecology is based on unstructured models, and those tell us what happens under these conditions of ontogenetic symmetry. Individuals are basically doing this, are more or less similar throughout their life. They may be larger, but they are proportionally larger than also in all their rates, and that is the condition that the classic theory applies to. This also means that the results I've shown you as a starting point is really due to symmetry breaking and asymmetry. So what is necessary to get that symmetry breaking, and what is and is it likely to occur? Well, with this simple system of consumers and adults, two classes where you have a foraging rate of juveniles on the resource, you have a foraging rate of adults on the resource, and you have a growth rate here, a maturation rate of juveniles to adults, and here the reproduction rate of adults. You can actually investigate its properties without doing any, without making any further assumptions about these functions. Just using an implicit function theorem and checking the stability criteria of this system, you can derive quite a lot of insight about it. And the main conclusion about it is that the predictions that the density goes down with mortality and that the equilibrium is stable hold as long as, except when one of these derivatives is negative. And the derivative is the derivative of the foraging rate of juveniles over the maturation rate, or the foraging rate of adults over their reproduction rate. These negative derivatives imply actually an increase in efficiency when you give an individual more food. Because if the feeding rate of an individual increases, but its maturation rate increases faster, that's what when this condition holds. The same, and this is for juveniles, the same holds for adults. So these two conditions tell you that the two predictions of the classic model, a decrease in density with mortality and a stable equilibrium, are invalidated as soon as the efficiency of juveniles or adults increases with an increase in resource density. The question then is, how can that come about? Well, what we classically do is say, well, okay, we have a resource and a consumer forages on that resource via a functional response. It's So what I did is actually I can look at the changes in equilibrium density in this system with mortality using implicit function theorem and go through a whole bunch of mathematics that is quite complicated, but in the end you actually can show that necessary conditions for an increase in density of juveniles or adults with mortality are these.
Okay, so necessary but not sufficient.
Yeah, I'm going to show you. Okay. That's what I'm going to show you. It's like this, but keep in mind that it has to do with an increase in efficiency with. If you give an individual a slightly more food, it does much better. That is basically the loose interpretation of these conditions. So usually foraging food intake is modeled using this functional response that saturates at a certain level. And then the response in terms of reproduction is modeled as a function that's proportional to it. This doesn't change the efficiency if you change resources. The thing that does actually change is something that's very elementary in biology, is that we all need maintenance costs to pay off our energy requirements for just existing. Maintenance cost means that there is actually a range of resource densities where you take in food, but you cannot do anything because you're just covering your own basic requirements. And it's in this condition that you actually can get this increase in efficiency, because at low mortality, then usually the system is controlled at the equilibrium just above this breaking point. If you now kill off some individuals and thereby realize an increase in 20% of food, then you lose 20% maybe in density, but it doubles the adult fecundity in this case. So killing off adults, reducing their density, actually leads to a 60% increase in total reproduction. So what really happens is that in this case, adult efficiency increases. Because at low mortality, you are just above this breaking point. There are many adults around that just take up food, and they just use it to sustain themselves. They don't use it for effective production. If you kill off some individual, reduce the density, they have more to realize effective production. So in other words, what you can actually see is that this mortality works positively because it decreases maintenance losses and increases effective use of resource for population growth. No, there's no cannibalism. We have worked a lot on cannibalism as well. I could give also a nice lecture about cannibalism, but I've thrown that out for today. So here is a simple example where I now have filled in these two functions, or these different functions. It's a model with a linear functional response. And the only interesting things are this, that I assume that you have both juveniles and adults have to pay a certain cost, T, which are the maintenance costs, and that production, so maturation and reproduction, only takes place as soon as you have more food intake than this maintenance cost. So the plus here means that it is bounded to positive values. And in this case, you indeed get this phenomenon that an increase in adult mortality rate increases adult density. And it has to do with, I can show, because it's linear functional responses, you see here the intake rate linearly going up with resource density. The fecundity, the reproduction rate goes up linearly, and the maturation rate as well. But as you can see, the maturation rate is controlled just above the cutoff place. And so what happens here is that this little increase in resource density doubles, or more than doubles, the maturation rate. And that actually fuels the increase in density among the adults. You have two different regimes. Either reproduction is more limited by food, or development is more limited by food. And they give the similar patterns. If reproduction is more limited by food, then juvenile density will go up with mortality. Adult density will go up with mortality when development is the limiting process in the life cycle. Yeah. So there is here no built-in increase in mortality with density, if that's what you mean. Yeah. Your argument about, or your question about, like, why wouldn't I see an increase in mortality with density? That's also an evolutionary argument. I mean, why would you actually shorten your life for the good of the population? That's an that evolutionarily, that kind of arguments are always quite difficult, because it's a kind of group selection argument. That whereas the selection really happens at the level of the individual. But to be fair, I mean, you can actually you can actually make the mortality dependent on resources as well. Only the conditions for symmetry and asymmetry become more complicated in that case. The same phenomena happens, actually. Okay, so we have these two different regimes. And what you can see is that we have either reproduction more limited by food, then we have this overcompensation in juvenile density. And if the development is more limited by food, then we have this overcompensation in adult density. And this is the symmetry axis, basically, where reproduction and development are equally limited by food. Notice that this occurs when mortality losses are small compared to maintenance losses. And usually, you have to realize that average losses of maintenance and mortality are about a factor 7 to 1. So basically, we are, if you take the scaling laws from metabolic ecology, then you are about here or so in this value range. So this is all about the details, about why these changes in structure of a population occur with mortality. And it's very nitty-gritty to understand where it comes from. But the two necessary ingredients are on one hand, juvenile-adult differences and basic maintenance costs. Two things that are so essentially biological that, yeah, the question is, can you ignore them? But this increase in mortality and this change in structure with mortality has implications beyond consumers and resources, and leads to a kind of self-organization in communities. And that's what I want to. That varies so much, in the sense that we go all the way from univoltine individual species that reproduce once and are short-lived as adults, to a mammalian species where the juvenile phase is actually rather short compared to the whole lifespan. So there is no general, I don't think there is a general statement to be made about that. And if there is one, I wouldn't know it, actually. The first thing that can come about is that you have a predator population that forages only on the adults of a species. But if mortality on adults increases adult density, it means that predation on adults actually increases the amount of food for that predator. So there is a positive relationship between predation pressure and food availability for the predator, which leads to this bistable character of the equilibrium curves. So this is the classic pattern if we don't have any maintenance cost, or if there are no differences between juveniles and adults. Predator mortality, increasing predator mortality will just decrease the top trophic level and increase the bottom trophic level. But in fact, if you have this ontogenetic asymmetry, then an increase in predator mortality will lead to a curve with a decrease that is much smaller, but then a collapse. And there is actually a region of alternative stable states where both a community without predators and a community with predators is present. And we have actually related that type of bistability to things that occur in fish populations, for example, in the Northwest Atlantic, where cod disappeared. And what you see when cod disappeared, the size structure of its prey changed completely, which, according to what we claim, actually is one of the reasons that contributed to its lack of recovery. So here, a predator helps itself. There is also what you call an Lee effect. There is a threshold. A predator at low density has no chance to survive. Predator needs a high density to actually survive and establish itself. Well, what happens if you add a predator on the juveniles? Essentially, they are competing for the same prey. But strangely enough, they aren't. This predator on juveniles helps the predator on adults. If you look at this is without the predator on juveniles, this is with the predator on adults, on juveniles. And as you can see, the range over which this predator on adults can persist is actually 5 times larger, just because it has a competitor that feeds on the juveniles. And the reason for that is that this predator just relaxes competition in the prey population, and hence keeps the structure in a way that is positive for the other predator. Things get even more weird if you have competitors in there with a shared predator. So now I have two competitors that feed on the same resource, and you have a shared predator. Well, if I assume that this predator, this consumer here, where there is no differences between juvenile and adult, so there is no asymmetry, if that's the better competitor, then classic theory actually tells me that it has to be fed on more by the predator to actually have any chance of coexisting. So you need this, you have to balance this advantage with a disadvantage in predation. For the other consumer, I actually have assumed that adults are more productive, and so the maturation process is more limiting the growth of the population. And now I assume that this predator has two handicaps. It's a worse competitor, and it's eaten more by the predator. And they are significant handicaps. It needs 30% more food, and it is actually fed upon at a 30% higher rate. I'll just show you a time simulation of what happens. I start out with this double handicap loser, as I call it. On its own, you introduce its competitor, and it's outcompeted. That's logical, because the other consumer has a lower R star value, so it outcompetes its opponent. And then you introduce the predator, knock down the dominant species. But in fact, the one that comes back is the one with the two handicaps. That is a worse competitor, and B is more foraged on by the predator. And the reason that it comes back is actually this change in structure. Notice that here, the density of adults relative to the juveniles is much higher than on this side. And so, in effect, this predator has increased the efficiency of this double handicap loser that allows it to eradicate its opponents. Yeah? Yeah. Absolutely. I mean, this is so. Yes, you are absolutely right. If it's close to zero like this, stochastic fluctuations would take it to zero. The only thing I want to illustrate is actually like if there is some kind of possibility to come back, then this consumer will come back. I mean, if you have a little bit of immigration, you can solve that problem, and the species will all persist on a low level. Yeah, this is a purely deterministic system. It's 4 differential equations. You can almost analyze for the equations.
And is there some understanding of, like, you know, there's all these different time scales in the problem? Like,
yeah.
Do you have some understanding?
Well, Yes, I do have an understanding what they mean. I mean, you can see several different phases. First of all, this phase is really the competition between the two consumers. Then you introduce the predator, and as you can see, the densities of the prey are hammered down to a kind of almost stable level. And the predator takes up a step, but then only when the second, so this double handicapped species comes back, then the predator can actually increase in density again. And why is that? Well, that's because it has a 10% higher foraging rate on this other. I introduced them at t equals 300, and I introduced the other competitor t equals 100. Just to illustrate, like, the mechanism of that, these changes in population structure actually completely turn around the basic expectations from models that you, where you do not include the population structure. And this happens over a large part of the parameter space. So coexistence is actually not very often occurring. It's in this coexistence of all four species occurs here, but most of the time you actually have this this species that has a double handicap, but has this ontogenetic asymmetry dominating the community. And you can have handicaps up to 30%, as I showed you. So the last week that I was here, actually, I worked on the question, how does this affect food webs? What does this also have effects on food webs that we do not expect otherwise? So what I did was simulated food webs where I constructed the food web initially using the niche model. I don't know, I think that everybody has heard it before, but I took 500 species initially, randomly distributed them over a niche axis from between 0 and 1, and I connected that with this niche axis with a logarithmic body size axis to give the species a body size value. And then every species gets a range, a feeding range, and a midpoint at which it feeds. The basic system of equations I built up slowly. It's similar to what I showed before. There is a reproduction rate. Adults reproduce juveniles. And notice that there is now a type 2 functional response. There is a maturation rate, juveniles, that also pops up here. And there is base background mortality of juveniles and adults. And the food is basically all the species that fit in, that are in the niche of a particular consumer species. The foraging rate end up as additional sum lost terms into two equations. But the important things are now that I introduce two sources of asymmetry. First of all, asymmetry in feeding. So there is an asymmetry in the juvenile adult feeding. That's this parameter Q that shows up everywhere here and there and there and there and there. I will show you results where adults feed more than juveniles, which is a logical assumption. The other asymmetry is that I will actually assume that juveniles are more prone to be foraged on than adults. So juveniles are usually exposed to more predation than adults, so the predation pressure on them is higher. For the basals, I have one basal species. So everything is supported by a single basal species, and I have assumed that the food level is set by a kind of resource density. This expression actually comes from an underlying model that the basal species has its own resource density on which it forages on via a linear functional response. The plus signs means that it's restricted to. So if I don't take any into account any structure, any difference, and no juvenile and adults at all in the system, This is classically the pattern I get. I can at most let three species, sometimes nine, but most of the time it's three, four species that can persist. This is the type of food webs I get, linear, sometimes branched. If you take this population structure, this is the distribution you get. So you get about 10 species coexisting with food webs like this. A single species, this is the basal species feeding on a resource, and that single basal species actually supports a network of interactions that looks like this, or sometimes has no omnivory at all, but it's like a tree-like structure. One of the classic questions in ecology is like, are larger communities more stable? Well, here are for all the community sizes, the coefficient of variation in density, total species density, if you have no structure at all, or actually if there is this asymmetry. So you see that the coefficient of variation doesn't really go up much with community size. It stays around 0.2 or so. And if you, for example, compare these two food webs, the dynamics, then in the absence of any juvenile adult structure, you see the typical classical predator-prey cycle: large amplitude going along zero, almost going extinct, no stochastic fluctuations here, so fully deterministic. But this is the classical predator-prey cycles. Whereas if I have this more complex structure, you see that there are completely different types of cycles occur that actually are related to the structure in juveniles and adults and to the asymmetry between juveniles and adults. And they are bounded away from zero, as you can see here. So the effects also, this asymmetry also has quite substantial effects in food webs, and it promotes diversity and community stability.
What's species one?
Species one is the basal species. So the conceptual question that I always pose at the end of my lectures is like, do models without development provide us generality? Because this is in ecology always the question that you ask, like, yeah, but the simple models are more general. And development is seen as a kind of complicating factor. So my answer actually is, development is not a complicating factor. Development is actually a constituent part of population dynamics. And the reason is that it's very different from something like spatial heterogeneity or genetic variability. Because these two sources of variations in populations, we can actually rule out experimentally. Chemostats have been done well to exclude any form of spatial heterogeneity. Genetic variation you can exclude by doing experiments with clonal or isofemale lines. But development, you cannot think of an experiment situation. Development does not play a role. And so my claim is actually that development is par with reproduction and mortality. It's an essential element of population dynamics, in contrast to what the classic definition says. So I hope I've shown you that demographic differences between life stages and basic maintenance costs, which are two essential elements of life, I would say, lead to these positive relationships between density and mortality, changes in population structure with mortality, and also to population cycles. I haven't been talking about that, but actually this asymmetry, this ontogenetic asymmetry, gives rise to two distinct forms of cycles in a population. And in turn, these changes in structure with mortality, they have effects in communities. They lead to self-organization in biological communities. You get alternative stable states because there are these positive feedbacks of a predator on its own food resource. You have facilitation between predators that help each other.
you get dominance of species that are poor competitors but also are experiencing higher predation, and you have larger and more stable communities by a single resource. So it's, in my opinion, time to change, to think differently about like what is general in population ecological theory. And I think that models that ignore development, you cannot consider general, because adding these two essential biological ingredients actually invalidates them. So thank you for your attention, and I'm happy to answer any questions. Stephanie.